Now we move on to the welfare state. In this section about the welfare state, we'll look at Britain in the 1930s, the impact of the Second World War, William Beveridge and the Five Giants, and what happened after the war. First, what was welfare like for the people of Britain in the 1930s? After the First World War, Lloyd George had wanted to create a home fit for heroes to live in. But the government was in debt after the war, and the situation grew worse during the Depression of the 1930s. Watch the next clip, then pause the tape and make notes of what life was like in Britain in the 1930s.
The unemployment rate between 1929 and 1932 was nearly 30%. The central belt of Scotland was badly affected. Many of the unemployed were skilled workers.
I can remember at one point in my childhood when I think there was four men in the street working, of whom my father was one, and none of them were working at their trade.
Now, what actually happened was they walked the streets idle, and they used to go down every day to Leith Docks, it was Sir Henry Robb's, and see if there were any work. And there would maybe be quite a crowd of them standing, and it all depended how the gaffer felt. And he would just look at them and he'll say, "You, you, you, and you," and maybe only take four, and they would get a couple of, maybe a couple of fortnight's work or something like that.
As more people lost their jobs, the cost of supporting them with unemployment benefit reached crisis point. In 1931, the government cut the dole by 10%. They made everyone claiming it take a means test. It made life even harder for many families by investigating the whole household to find out if anyone was earning money.
The inspectors would come, the officials would come, and if you had anything in your house that was of any value, if you had an ornament that you could sell, you had to sell it.
Some of the unemployed devoted their time to protests. The hunger marches, as they were called, began in 1922 and continued for 16 years.
I went in them. The children went with their parents. We went with their parents and shouting and carrying on.
In 1933, unemployment in Britain reached 3.5 million. In Dundee, unemployed workers clashed with the police and there was serious rioting in Glasgow. In the 1920s, almost 500,000 people emigrated to places like America to escape the poverty.
So how did you get on? You should have noted unemployment, dole queues, and the means test. During the 1930s, many people in Britain suffered great hardship. The National Insurance Acts only applied to the worker and not to his family. You should already know that unemployment benefits stopped after 12 months, and families had to apply for the dole and face the means test before it was approved. This meant having an inspector go through the house, savings accounts, and belongings. Families could be forced to sell property before they received any help. Remember that medical treatment was only available for the worker. Wives and children usually had to pay for visits to the doctor and for any medicines that were prescribed. Many women went without to make sure that their children were looked after. As you know, many politicians didn't believe that it was the government's responsibility to look after all of the people. They believed that it was impossible to improve the health of the nation. That's the end of the section on Britain in the 1930s. So what impact did the Second World War have on plans for changes? During the Second World War, the government began to control many aspects of everyday life. It would never have done this in peacetime, but the war meant that it couldn't be avoided. Watch the following clip, then pause the tape and make notes on why attitudes began to change during the war.
Many of the soldiers who fought in the front line were the same men who had stood in the dole queues of the 1930s and faced the humiliation of the means test. They remember too the disappointment of their fathers, who had fought in the First World War for a land fit for heroes, and were determined that this time promises would be delivered. On the home front too, the war made a big impact.
Calling all workers!
In the industry supporting the war effort, there was a new atmosphere of cooperation and consideration. There was no place for conflict that might threaten production targets. It was important to have a happy, healthy workforce.
Music party welcome with Dave Hill this morning on Ridley Records.
The BBC transmitted programmes to brighten up the working day. Crèches were opened up to make life easier for working mothers. Management and workers had meetings to improve working conditions. Standards of health and welfare were raised. Everything that could be done to keep spirits up was done. New canteens brought not only hot lunches, but sometimes morale-boosting concerts. The war broke down class barriers.
Apart from anything else in any office such as ours, besides the day's work, we would go straight on to fire watching at night. And a managing director would fire watch with the office boy and the junior typist. Five or six people, and then they'd all dossed down in great discomfort in one of the offices with rugs that were provided for the purpose. So everybody had to muck in with everybody else. During the war, we all talked to anyone we found ourselves with. If you were in a railway carriage, you talked to the other people in the railway carriage. If you were sitting on a bench in the park, you talked to the other people sitting on the bench. In buses, we all talked. It was a totally different atmosphere.
The air raid shelters especially encouraged this community spirit.
Well, what do we have? All right, come on then.
Here, differences of background were forgotten and friendships were made. To escape the bombing, children were evacuated from the towns. This let people see how the other half lived. Middle-class country ladies were shocked when they met up with some of these evacuated children. Those coming from the slums of the industrial cities were often in an appalling physical condition, undernourished, badly clothed, and suffering from all kinds of skin infections. Guilt and shame led to promises of future action.
You should have spotted memories of the 1930s, people mixing, and evacuation. Memories of the 1930s were very important. After all of the sacrifices during the war, they wanted a better life for the people of Britain when it came to an end. People from different social classes mixed much more during the war. They found out more about each other's lives. This helped to bring people closer together. Evacuation showed just how bad a state some children were in. Some families were horrified when they received their evacuees. They had skin diseases and were suffering from malnourishment. In 1941, the Women's Institute published a report which described the problem. This helped force the government to act. You should also remember that rationing was introduced to try to make sure that people in Britain had enough to eat. It meant that people ate less meat and fat and instead had more vegetables and potatoes. The result was that people became far healthier. At the same time, children were given special supplements such as orange juice and cod liver oil. Pregnant women also received special treatment. This proved that people could be made healthier. remember that housing was badly damaged by bombing and would need to be replaced after the war. In fact, it soon became clear that after all the sacrifices that the British people had made during the war, something better had to come out of it. It was this feeling that helped lead to the idea of the welfare state. That's the end of the section on the impact of the Second World War. Now we move on to Sir William Beveridge and the Five Giants. In 1941, the government set up a commission to look into what should be done after the war. William Beveridge was in charge, and in 1942, he produced the Beveridge Report. Watch the following clip and note down what was in the Beveridge Report.
What were the effects of war on the people of Britain? A greater awareness of poverty. A sense of common purpose. The removal of social barriers. A greater desire for change. Planning for peacetime. During the war, a civil servant called Sir William Beveridge produced a report in which he laid out his plan for a better Britain. This newspaper cartoon shows the five giants that Beveridge thought had to be killed.
Want must not be known again. Idleness. There must be no mass unemployment. The giant evil of only yesterday. Ignorance, says Sir William, no democracy can nowadays afford. Disease. The evil of disease must be overthrown. The voluntary hospital and the expensive nursing home are not enough to maintain this nation in good health. Squalor. We are not fighting to preserve slums, which feed our own diseases just as swamps feed malaria. No more generations must be stunted in squalor.
You should have spotted a welfare state and the five giants. Beveridge recommended that a welfare state should be set up after the war. By this he meant that the state should take responsibility for the welfare of the people of Britain. It should help support them when they were young, old, or couldn't work, and it should provide medical treatment when they needed it. Beveridge listed five giant evils that the government had to tackle. They were squalor, idleness, ignorance, want, and disease. The government should make sure that the people of Britain didn't suffer from any of these. You should already know that Beveridge's plan was that state help should run from the cradle to the grave. In other words, as soon as a baby was born, there should be some form of help, and this should last until the person was buried. That's the end of the section on Beveridge and the Five Giants. Now let's look at what happened after the war. In 1945, the Labour Party won the general election and immediately began to put the Beveridge Report into practice. Watch the following clip and note down all the changes that the Labour government made in the years from 1945 to 1950.
Tackling the giant of want was Beveridge's own specific task. In his report, he proposed insurance benefits to rid the unemployed, the sick and the old from the fear of poverty, and a family allowance to help parents meet the cost of children.
Well, Sir William, you seem to have thought of everything.
The family allowance became law in 1945.
And there's shoes for Betty and a suit for George.
I'm not made of money. It's impossible to go on like this. But wait a minute. I've just read a piece about family allowances. We can get 10 shillings a week for our three.
The following year, the National Insurance Scheme was made law.
How old are you?
Old age pensions. The government introduced a better deal than Beveridge had suggested. Sickness benefit. This went up by 8 shillings a week.
If you are ill, to claim sickness benefit, you must get a medical certificate from your doctor. He will fill in this...
The insurance scheme came into operation in 1948, on the same date as the start of the attack on the giant disease.
On July 5th, the new National Health Service starts, providing hospital and specialist services, medicines, drugs and appliances, care of the teeth and eyes, maternity services.
Now this transformed the health care of the people of this country, and the people loved it. They were absolutely thrilled to find that they could go to a doctor and get free the expert advice they needed, their consultant's advice if they needed it, hospital treatment if they needed, and they were paying nothing while they were sick.
Let's have a practical demonstration. Off you go to the doctor. You have some unusual illness which can't be diagnosed. He'll no doubt wish you to see a specialist. In hospital, you'll be under observation. This will include X-ray if it's found necessary.
Prior to the introduction of the NHS, free medical treatment was available to insured workers, but not their wives or children. Doctors had to be paid for.
All your life you're aware of, oh no, you better watch, can't go to the doctor, it costs five shillings. And when you went to the doctor, you had to have the 5 shillings in your hand. With it, I mean, you couldn't just go. You had to have it in your hand and the other wouldn't treat you. And it was just a terrible thing that, so poor people just didn't go at all. And my mother, she had this trouble, and she was losing blood, and I said about the doctor, no, it's just a change of life, it's just normal. She said it was just normal, just natural, just normal. And she wouldn't go to the doctor. No, it's quite natural. All women go through this, you know, change of life, and I, of course, didn't think there was anything to it. And when she finally did go to the doctor, when my father sort of, I think she had a flooding or something, and went to the doctor, it was too late. The cancer had spread right through her body, at 42 years of age.
The National Health Service didn't just make hospitals and doctors freely available to all. Other forms of medical care, like dentists and opticians, were part of the service. Now everybody could get glasses and dentures for nothing.
My mother and dad had been having problem with the teeth for ages, and I think they were the first at the dentist. As soon as they opened, they were there for an appointment. Well, instead of having just a few teeth out, they had the complete sets out and free dentures. You know, that it was wonderful.
There was a huge demand for all the NHS services. Dentists, doctors and opticians were overwhelmed with people wanting treatment. Some said that this showed what happened if you offered something for nothing. Others said that it was evidence that lack of money had prevented people from seeking treatment before. Whatever the reason, it meant that the costs of the NHS were much higher than expected and threatened the continuation of a totally free service. Of all the giants, idleness was the one which lingered most vividly in the memories of those who lived through the 30s, the years of mass unemployment and depression. High unemployment was a scourge in its own right, but as Beveridge warned, it could have caused the collapse of his whole social security scheme. A welfare system didn't come free. Britain could only afford one if its people were in work producing the goods, creating the wealth to pay for it. So the government had to have economic policies that ensured full employment. This graph of unemployment levels between 1931 and 1951 shows just how successful they were in achieving that. Before the war, unemployment ranged between 1.5 million and almost 3 million. After the war, it never rose above 500,000. The post-war Labour government mounted a sustained attack on the five giants, and in doing so, established the welfare state in Britain, with the National Health Service as its crowning glory.
You should have spotted the National Health Service, National Insurance, and family allowances. The National Health Service came into being in 1948. All the people of Britain could receive medical treatment completely free of charge for the first time. The National Insurance Act came into effect at the same time. All workers in Britain were now covered, and so were their families. Both schemes were paid for by national insurance contributions made by workers and employers. Any further expenses were covered by the state. The Labour government also provided family allowances. These were weekly payments for children to help with their upbringing. There was no payment for the first child, only for the second and third. Now, these are called child benefit payments. You should also know that national assistance covered anybody who was not entitled to national insurance benefits. This might be people who were too old to work. The Labour government began a big housing programme and built 800,000 new houses to replace areas that had been destroyed during the war. Here's a typical question you might get on this topic. Why was a welfare state introduced after the Second World War? Okay, so let's work through it. Remember, this question is asking to explain why a welfare state was introduced. It's not asking you to describe the welfare state, so to get the best marks, you must sort the reasons into the correct order and explain how one led to another. First, note down your main points and then spend about 15 minutes writing an answer to the question. So, stop, rewind the tape, have another look at this whole section, then have a go. Your plan should look something like this. The effects of evacuation and rationing, destruction of housing, the sacrifices of the British people, the Beveridge Report, and the Labour government. That's the end of the section on the welfare state. That's the end of the programme on modern British history. The other two programmes on history are Modern World History and the School's History Project, which looks at medicine through time and the American West. Don't forget, you can find more information in the GCSE bite-sized books and on the website at www.bbc.co.uk/